Welcome to the Altium Speeding Edge series on high-speed design. My name is Lee Ritchey, Speeding Edge. We specialize in high-speed design. What we're going to do with this video is ask a question that, or answer a question that designers ask me all the time. Why is impedance matching needed? First of all, what is impedance and why does it matter? Transmission line impedance is the resistance, the flow of energy down the transmission line. In a previous video, the one on what is high speed design, we talked about how when we drive a transmission line, we send energy down it in the form of an electromagnetic field. What I'm going to show in the next slide is the electrical equivalent of a transmission line so we can see what is going on. What you'll see is a distributed network. This is a diagram we use all of the time to analyze transmission lines, and you'll notice across the top there is a string of letters with O at both ends, the O's meaning input and output, and you'll see R's, L's, R's, L's, R's, L's. The R is resistance of the copper, which probably everyone's familiar with. The L is not always something you know about, but all wires have inductance along the length. And then you can see C is going from the L's to P, which I am calling here the plane. And so those elements are what determine how that transmission line is going to behave. And we'll see in a minute that the L and the C are going to determine what the impedance is. If the C is big, impedance will be low. If the C is small, it will be high. The L will be about the same no matter what structure we have, roughly, 3.5 nanohenries per inch of length. And on the bottom left and right, you'll see two equations, X sub C, which is the reactance impedance of a capacitor. And you'll notice that if F is zero, X sub C is infinity. And that's why at DC, we only look at the R of the wires, because at those frequencies, the C is not doing anything of significance. Bottom right, you'll see the reactance equation for an inductor. And if F equals zero, X sub L is zero, and we ignore that. Well, as soon as the frequency goes away from zero, those two reactances become much, much bigger than the R's, and they will determine what that transmission line looks like. In the next slide, we'll see how we're going to use those two values to determine the impedance of the line. Again, you saw there I did a distributed network, the C we're going to have to charge up as we switch that line. The two parasitics, the L and the C, interact in such a way that they are what determine what the impedance of the line is, meaning how hard it is to send energy down that line. We are going to find out what L0 and C0 are with a tool called a field solver. And there are lots of those around. I believe that Altium has one in its current tool set. Bottom right, you can see the equation for Z0, where L0 is in the numerator and C0 is in the denominator. When we manipulate values to come to a certain impedance, Z0, we'll discover in printed circuit boards that the only variable we have to work with is C0. And we're going to make that larger or smaller by two things, raising the height above the nearest plane and changing the trace width. You'll see that L0 is not much of a variable. So those who are worried about coming to some impedance are going to manipulate C0. So what happens if the impedance changes along the path? Well, what's going to happen is some of the energy that you sent down the line with the intent of making some circuit work at the receiver, like a radio or a logic circuit, will reflect back to the source, and the load won't see it, meaning that the signal at the load will be diminished. And how much of that reflection occurs, you calculate with the equation in the bottom right of this slide, where Z sub L is the impedance downstream from the change, and Z0 is the impedance upstream. And if you do a little what-ifing, you can see that, imagine that the impedance change goes from low impedance to high, meaning that ZL is larger than Z0. This equation tells you there'll be a reflection that is positive and adds to, and we saw that on the what is high speed presentation, where I showed you a switching waveform for a series terminated line. If we reverse that, where Z0 is larger than ZL, meaning that the impedance downstream of a change is higher, we'll see that the value here is negative, meaning that the reflection takes away from the signal you sent, and that usually is the one that we are interested in preventing from happening. And of course, that last bullet there is what I just talked about. The polarity depends on what the change looks like, whether we go up or down in impedance at the change. So here are structures that have impedances that we'll encounter designing printed circuit boards. And a printed circuit board, which is most of us are dealing with, it's a trace, which that's the transmission line, and the plane or planes over which it travels. If we are on outside layer of a board, it will be only one plane, and we call that microstrip. If it's in the middle of the board somewhere, there'll be two planes, one on each side of the trace, and that has the name strip line. In coaxial cable, we have a center conductor and then a surrounding shield, and so that's the structure where the impedance is between the center conductor and the shield. Twisted pair, which we all are familiar with from wired Ethernet, the impedances between the two members of the pair. Here are places impedance changes can happen. If we change the trace width in the same layer, and that has been a practice for years, where we quote neck down to fit a trace through some pin field, that practice has to stop because that will be an impedance change that causes a problem or could cause a problem. When you change layers and the two layers are not the same impedance, that will do the same thing. I believe this is where the notion that vias cause reflections comes from. It happens that that's where the layer change took place. It's not the via that caused the problem. Into and out of connectors. Most connectors are not 50 ohms, and most everything that we design in printed circuit boards is. So that's a place where we can have a reflection or impedance change. If we cluster loads all in one place on a net, that means we have locally put a bunch of C. And if you go back to the schematic of my transmission line, if I have a lot of C in one spot on the board, that local spot's going to have a lower impedance. Now, here is something you've probably been told and is not so. Right angle bends are not a place where reflections happen. That's a myth that got started with an error in a design guide published by Motorola in 1974. Well, I hope this video helped you understand what's going on with impedance and reflections. If you did, pass it on to your colleagues. If you have any ideas about other topics we ought to cover, feel free to send your request in to Altium and we'll see what we can do about that. Again, my name is Lee Ritchey, Speeding Edge. I'm doing this with Altium as part of their education series. Thanks for watching.